Of the Two Voices, originally called The Thoughts of a Suicide, by Alfred Lord Tennyson. A still small voice spake unto me, Thou art so full of misery, were it not better not to be? Then to the still small voice I said, Let me not cast in endless shade what is so wonderfully made. To which the voice did urge reply, Today I saw the dragonfly come from the wells where he did lie. An inner impulse rent the veil of his old husk. From head to tail came out clear plates of sapphire mail. He dried his wings. Like gauze they grew. Through crofts and pastures wet with dew, a living flash of light he flew. I said, When first the world began, young nature through five cycles ran, and in the sixth she moulded man. She gave him mind, the lordliest proportion, and, above the rest, dominion in the head and breast. Thereto the silent voice replied, Self-blinded are you by your pride. Look up through night, the world is wide. This truth within thy mind rehearse, that in a boundless universe is boundless better, boundless worse. Think you this mould of hopes and fears could find no statelier than his peers in yonder 100,000,000 spheres? It spake, moreover, in my mind, Though thou wert scattered to the wind, yet is there plenty of thy kind. Then did my response clearer fall. No compound of this earthly ball is like another all in all. To which he answered scoffingly, Good soul, suppose I grant it thee, who'll weep for thy deficiency? Or will one beam be less intense when thy peculiar difference is cancelled in the world of sense? I would have said, Thou canst not know, but my full heart that worked below reigned through my sight its overflow. Again the voice spake unto me, Thou art so steeped in misery, surely to a better not to be. Thine anguish will not let thee sleep, nor any train of reason keep. Thou canst not think, but thou wilt weep. I said, The years with change advance. If I make dark my countenance, I shut my life from happier chance. Some turn this sickness yet might take, e'en yet. But he, what drug can make a withered palsy cease to shake? I said, When I am gone away, he dead not tarry, men will say, doing dishonour to my clay. This is more vile, he made reply, to breathe and loathe, to live and sigh, than once from dread of pain to die. Sick art thou, a divided will, still heaping on the fear of ill, the fear of men, a coward still. Do men love thee? Art thou so bound to men, that how thy name may sound will vex thee lying underground? Go, vexed spirit, sleep in trust. The right ear that is filled with dust hears little of the false or just. Hard task to pluck resolve, I cried, from emptiness and the waste wide of that abyss, or scornful pride. Nay, rather yet that I could raise one hope that warmed me in the days when I still yearned for human praise. Yea, said the voice, thy dream was good, while thou abodest in the bud. It was the stirring of the blood. If nature put not forth her power about the opening of the flower, who is it that could live an hour? Then comes the check, the change, the fall. Pain rises up, old pleasures pall. There is one remedy for all. Yet hadst thou, through enduring pain, linked month to month with such a chain of knitted purport, all were vain. Thou hadst not, between death and birth, dissolved the riddle of the earth, so were thy labour little worth. That men with knowledge merely played, I told thee, hardly naiad, though scaling slow from grade to grade. Much less this dreamer, deaf and blind, named man, may hope some truth to find that bears relation to the mind. For every worm beneath the moon draws different threads, but late and soon spins, toiling out his own cocoon. And owning but a little more than beasts, abidest lame and poor, calling thyself a little lower than angels, cease to wail and brawl. Why, inch by inch, to darkness crawl? There is one remedy for all. O dull one-sided voice, said I, wilt thou make everything a lie, to flatter me that I may die? I know that age to age succeeds, blowing a noise of tongues and deeds, a dust of systems and of creeds. I cannot hide that some have striven, achieving calm, to whom was given the joy that mixes man with heaven, who, rowing hard against the stream, saw distant gates of Eden gleam, and did not dream it was a dream. I said I toil beneath the curse, but knowing not the universe, I fear to slide from bad to worse. And that in seeking to undo one riddle and to find the true, I knit 100 others new. Or that this anguish, fleeing hence, unmanacled from bonds of sense, be fixed and frozen to permanence. For I go, weak from suffering here, naked I go, and void of cheer. What is it that I may not fear? Consider well, the voice replied, his face that 2 hours since hath died. Wilt thou find passion, pain, or pride? Will he obey when one commands? Or answer, should one press his hands? He answers not, nor understands. His palms are folded on his breast. There is no other thing expressed but a long disquiet merged in rest. His lips are very mild and meek, though one should smite him on the cheek, and on the mouth he will not speak. He will not hear the north wind rave, nor moaning household shelter crave from winter rains that beat his grave. High up the vapours fold and swim, about him broods the twilight dim, the place he knew forgetteth him. If all be dark, vague voice I said, these things are wrapped in doubt and dread, nor canst thou show the dead are dead. As when a billow blown against falls back, the voice with which I fenced a little ceased, but recommenced. Where wert thou when thy father played in his free field, and a pastime made, a merry boy in sun and shade? A merry boy they called him then. He sat upon the knees of men in days that never come again. Before the little ducts began to feed thy bones with lime, and ran their course till thou wert also man, who took a wife, who reared his race, whose wrinkles gathered on his face, whose troubles number with his days. A life of nothings, nothing worth, from that first to nothing, ere his birth, to that last nothing under earth. These words, I said, are like the rest, no certain clearness, but at best a vague suspicion of the breast. But if I grant thou mightest defend the thesis which thy words intend, that to begin implies to end. Yet how should I for certain hold, because my memory is so cold, that I first was in human mould? It may be that no life is found, which only to one engine bound falls off, but cycles always round. As old mythologies relate, some draught of Lethe might await the slipping through from state to state. As here we find, in trances men forget the dream that happens then, until they fall in trance again. Or if, through lower lives I came, though all experience past became consolidate in mind and frame, I might forget my weaker lot, for is not our first year forgot? The haunts of memory echo not. Much more, if I first floated free as naked essence, must I be incompetent of memory? Moreover, something is, or seems, that touches me with mystic gleams, like glimpses of forgotten dreams. The still voice laughed. I talk, said he, not with thy dreams. Suffice it thee, thy pain is a reality. But thou, said I, hast missed thy mark, who sought to wreck my mortal ark by making all the horizon dark. Why not set forth, if I should do this rashness, that which might ensue with this old soul in organs new? Whatever crazy sorrow saith, no life that breathes with human breath has ever truly longed for death. 'Tis life whereof our nerves are scant. O life, not a death for which we pant. More life and fuller, that I want. I ceased, and sat as one forlorn. Then, said the voice, in quiet scorn, behold, it is the Sabbath morn. And I arose, and I released the casement, and the light increased with freshness in the dawning east. Unto God's house the people pressed, passing the place where each must rest. Each entered like a welcome guest. One walked between his wife and child, with measured footfall, firm and mild, and now and then he gravely smiled. The prudent partner of his blood leaned on him, faithful, gentle, good, wearing the rose of womanhood. And in their double love, secure, the little maiden walked demure, pacing with downward eyelids pure. These three made unity so sweet, my frozen heart began to beat, remembering its ancient heat. I blessed them, and they wandered on. I spoke, but answer came there none. The dull and bitter voice was gone. A second voice was at mine ear, a little whisper, silver clear, a murmur, be of better cheer. As from some blissful neighbourhood, a notice faintly understood, I see the end, and know the good. Such seemed the whisper at my side. What is it thou knowest, sweet voice, I cried. A hidden hope, the voice replied. And forth into the fields I went, and nature's living motion lent the pulse of hope to discontent. I wondered at the bounteous hours, the slow result of winter showers. You scarce could see the grass for flowers. I wondered, while I paced along, the woods were filled so full with song, there seemed no room for sense of wrong. So variously seemed all things wrought, I marvelled how the mind was brought to anchor by one gloomy thought. And wherefore, rather, I made choice to commune with that barren voice than him that said, rejoice, rejoice.